Gardening is great for the soul and the planet, but if you're like me and you have two very not green thumbs, you can still help make the world healthier with your trash. Of course, I'm talking about compost. It's packed with nutrients that plants need to grow. And on top of all that, the compost pile itself is full of life. But there's more to it than just throwing your dinner scraps into a pile. The microbes that are making you the best fertilizer in town have needs, and that's where this video comes in. Here's how to make the best possible compost based on the ingredients microbes need to sustain their lives. For those of you new to the whole composting thing, we're going to break this down, no pun intended, into three parts: the setup, the active phase, and the curing phase. So let's start at the start, with setting up your compost pile. All compost starts with whatever you put in there. Ideally, you'd have a mixture of greens, like food scraps, and browns, like outdoor scraps, in the pile. But don't get too caught up on those color labels. Coffee grounds are literally brown, but in your compost heap, they're considered greens. The real difference between composting greens and browns is how much carbon versus nitrogen they have inside them. Food scraps, like coffee grounds and veggie scraps, tend to have more nitrogen in them, while outdoor waste, like dried leaves and wood chips, tend to have more carbon. They both have both of these elements. It's just a matter of how much, which is why your nitrogen-rich coffee grounds count as green. Soil and waste experts at the University of Idaho say that a carbon-to-nitrogen ratio of about 30:1 will put you on the path to success. So if you made a big stir-fry for dinner and have a ton of unused veggie stems that you want to toss, you can complement them with a nice bundle of leaves from outside. In your compost, that is. Please don't eat them. Complement them in your compost. And if you don't know whether something you want to compost is a green or a brown, you can look up online how much carbon and nitrogen is in pretty much anything you'd put in compost. Now, I know that adding a whole extra step of going outside and collecting even more stuff for your compost when all you wanted to do was get rid of your dinner waste seems laborious, but trust me, it's worth it. If there's too much nitrogen in your mixture, it'll break down into ammonia gas, and that is not a smell your neighbors will appreciate coming from your compost pile. You probably also shouldn't overload your compost with the 10 lemon husks left over from making a pitcher of lemonade all at once, since too much acid can lower the pH of the whole pile, which also leads to that ammonia smell. On the other hand, if there's not enough nitrogen, your compost heap won't be able to get hot enough to really make the magic happen fast. More on the heat in a minute. And while you're thinking about how long this whole composting thing is going to take, consider what your inputs are made out of. A lot of the same things that take us a long time to digest will take a while to break down in the compost too. Carbs are easier to break down than cellulose, which is easier to break down than lignin, another plant fiber. So fruits and veggies, which have lots of sugars and starch in them, aka simple carbs, break down fast, while wood and leaves are more packed with lignin, so they maintain your pile's structure for longer. Meanwhile, stuff that's full of water will release that moisture as it breaks down, which can give you less of a compost pile and more of a compost river, which is not what we want. You want your compost to have somewhere between 50 to 60% moisture content, so that your microbes have enough water and oxygen to do their job. That said, microbes are gonna microbe no matter what, so if your pile is a bit too wet or too dry, things will still break down. They need some water for them to move around and maintain their metabolism, but if you fill up all of the air gaps with water, then those microbes won't be able to breathe and it'll really start to smell like a pile of wet garbage. There's a very scientific squeeze test you can do to make sure you have the right moisture levels. Put on a glove, take a handful of your compost mix, and squeeze. You're looking for about a drop or two of water to come out. If it feels dry, you can add some water. If you've got a waterfall, you can add some dry ingredients. Or if you want to get really precise, you can use the gravimetric method. That's where you weigh a sample of your compost, cook it in a convection oven or microwave until totally dry, weigh it again, and calculate how much of the sample was water based on the difference. Once you have the moisture levels all worked out, the last thing to think about is the size of each item you're tossing. If everything you put into your compost is less than an inch around, it'll break down faster because of the surface area. But there's no need to break out your mortar and pestle to pulverize your compostables into confetti. Slightly bigger pieces means there'll be open space for that oh-so-vital oxygen your little microbes need to turn your potato peels into garden food. If you do a little bit of prep to break down a mixture of food and woody scraps for your microbe friends, they'll return the favor by taking on the breakdown from there. Now, everything I've said so far applies to the kind of compost that's just scraps. If you're working with worms or have a neighborhood compost pickup that does industrial processing, you might be able to handle handle a different combination of inputs. The big thing is that, well, you can put big things into the heap if you've got worms and machinery helping you out. But worm compost setups require a lot more maintenance because you need to keep their environment healthy for them. That basically just means harvesting your compost more promptly to make sure the worms haven't overwhelmed themselves with their own poop. Other than that, it's a similar process.
This episode is sponsored by Arizona State University's College of Global Futures. That's where you can learn how to create a more equitable, sustainable, and promise-filled future for everyone, and do it all online. ASU's programs help people make a positive impact on the world with their careers. For example, through ASU's online programs, you could earn a Master's of Science or graduate certificate in biomimicry. Biomimicry is a field where you can leverage or mimic biological principles to find new and innovative solutions to contemporary problems. You'll study biology, chemistry, and sustainability to examine how life has survived, evolved, and thrived on Earth. And you can apply that knowledge to fields like sustainability, engineering, and business. Or think a little bit more outside of the box and apply it to transportation, product design, architecture, and education. Maybe you'll even get a job in a related field like urban planning. You can start it all at ASU's online program. And thanks to ASU for supporting this SciShow video.
So that's the basics of setting up a good compost heap. But now let's talk about what it looks like when the magic happens. Your microscopic recycling team will eat the scraps in your compost pile to get the nutrients they need to live. While they're turning your trash into their energy, the pile will start to shrink down because of all the carbon they're taking out. So they're using up the carbon for their cells and for energy. And they're using the nitrogen in your pile to make their enzymes, proteins, amino acids, nucleic acids, and generally all the rest of the stuff they need to be alive. Once the microbes start using up the good carbon and nitrogen in your pile, things really start rolling in what's called the active phase of compost. As they breathe, they turn carbon into carbon dioxide, and that gas exchange starts shrinking the pile. But that shrinkage makes air pockets harder to come by, which is where you, the owner of the compost heap, come in. Depending on your setup, aerating your compost pile could be the most intensive part of the whole thing. For the kinds of setups that are a big container or even just a pile on the ground, you have to shovel it occasionally. You're turning over the compost to add air back into an oxygen-depleted system. But that's also why some compost setups are more like a drum or a wheel that you can spin, so you can take some of the manual labor out of the aeration process. You don't have to do this all the time, though. Generally, the compost will tell you when it needs more air. If you start to smell rotten eggs, that is a sign you might need to add some oxygen to your pile. Because that is the lovely scent of an anaerobic system, and that is not going to break down your waste into a usable final product. Or if you want to be more proactive and check on your pile's oxygen levels before it gets to that unfortunate point, there's another test to measure that too. You can weigh a sample of the compost, then completely saturate it with water so that all the air bubbles are filled. But make note of how much water it took to get to that point. Whatever volume of water you added can be presumed equal to the original volume of air minus the original sample volume. Whether it's by smell or measurements, you can get a sense for the amount of oxygen in your pile and tinker with it to keep your microbes healthy. And while you're managing the oxygen levels, you might also be addressing creeping temperatures in your pile. As your little trashy organisms become active, things will start to get hot in your compost heap, like 65 degrees Celsius hot. And you know who loves those warm environments? More productive microorganisms that get lured over to help out with your compost. With them on board, decomposition happens really quickly. That fast, hot decomposition is the main feature of the active stage of composting. Plus, there's an added bonus to those high temperatures. Seeds can't stay viable when it's that hot. So you can compost seeds without worrying about accidentally growing a tree in your pile. And soaring temperatures keep dangerous pathogens at bay too. But even microbes find some temperatures to be too hot. When it gets above 71 degrees Celsius, nobody's happy. And that's when you might aerate the pile or add water to lower the temperature. Once most of the nutrients are all used up and things start to cool off in the compost, those original microbes come back for the curing phase. Curing your compost just means that the cooler dwelling microbes are putting the finishing touches on the pile. This part of the process can be shorter or longer depending on how you approached the input stage. If you had wonky nutrient ratios earlier on, this step could literally take all year. But it really is important to give it the time it needs, because a product with the wrong balance of acids, salts, carbon, oxygen, and water can end up killing anything you try to grow in it. You'll know you've got a nice finished product when there's a moderate amount of water, somewhere in the 35 to 60% range. And in terms of salt, we're not talking about the fancy pink Himalayan salt you use to cook with. We're talking about electrolytes, Fruits and veggies have electrolytes like potassium in them, so when you're adding them to your pile, you're giving your microbes a little salty treat. Since you don't want your final product to be too salty, you can measure the salt content by testing its electrical conductivity. And this measure isn't just about salt, because it will be affected by how moist the mixture is, but you'll get a general idea of the amount of electrolytes in there. And if it's too salty, don't worry, because the microbes will eat that extra salt over time. Just let your microbial buddies keep on composting. And this is where you can be nice to yourself. Maybe you're watching this video after you started composting, and you're realizing that the conditions you set up at the beginning of your journey are suboptimal. That is okay. It is not a lost cause. It'll just take longer. When you've completed a full round of compost, that's when the coolest part happens. You get to use yesterday's discarded food scraps to grow tomorrow's meals. Then you can refill the compost pile and start all over again. But this time, you're already set up for success. There will still be microbes there ready to tackle the new compostable material when you add it. When you take care of the microscopic critters in your compost pile, they'll take care of your trash. It's all a matter of making sure they have the nutrients, water, air, and temperature they need to thrive in their favorite environment, your waste.